So in today's session, we will be having two sessions in the beginning for C programming. The first session will be just an introduction to C programming. And the second session here will be your that is the second chapter of C programming. Now in this C programming lectures, I am assuming that you have some knowledge of C programming. I am not assuming ki aapko kuch bhi nahi aata, because there are a few things which I have to tell you. If you do not know the basics of C programming, then maybe in some places you might face some issues, but aisa nahi hoga, but I'll try my best ki aapko samajh mein aaye. I'll try my best ki everything should be clear, but I'm expecting that you should have some basic knowledge of C programming. Okay, so in the introduction chapters, maine jo introduction chapter liya hai, I've not created this chapter in such a way that you are a beginner. So I'm just expecting that you know the basic syntax of C programming. You know, how can you initialize a variable, you know, how can you print some statements. Kuch basic cheeze aapko pata hogi. And after this, I tried my best ki is chapter ko main is tarike se banau. Even if you have studied C programming before, then still you will be able to learn something extra or something new. So this is your introduction chapter. So this is the first session of C programming where we'll be doing the introduction. Okay, so there are some parts which I will be leaving you to study. Jaise for example, this part is there, so I'm not going to explain a lot of thing about history and benefits of C language. There are some extra portions that I have included in the presentation which I believe that you can study by yourself. Okay, but again, I'll try my best ki main aapko wo cheeze bhi explain karne ki koshish karu. Okay, so the first chapter is history. So what is C programming? So C programming was developed at the AT&T Bell Laboratories in USA in 1972. Kab design hua tha? This was developed in 1972 in USA at AT&T Bell Laboratories. Okay, and who designed the C programming language? It is the man Dennis Ritchie. So this name is very important, because even if I suggest you that you can refer some book, so that book will be of Dennis Ritchie only, because this is book which is going to be very important and necessary for all of you. Okay, now yes, so now in the late 70s you used to have different languages, like you have Algol, so you have PL, SPL, and so on. There were different languages. So when the C language was designed, it was not designed as a language. The C language was developed to create the operating system Unix. So C language ko Unix operating system ke liye banaya gaya tha. And then they haven't publicized the language. They haven't made it they haven't started any kind of publications or advertisement. But still, without any kind of publications or advertisement, the programming language became so popular and famous that people started adopting the C language. So which really helped the C language, the reputation of C language was very, very good, right? Because it started spreading on its own. Nobody pushed the language, nobody started advertising the language. On its own, the language started spreading. So that time you used to have other languages, like you have Fortran, you have PL. So but again, the C language became more popular as compared to Fortran, and as you know, these days we are not even using the languages like Fortran. Okay, so what is the reason why the C language became so popular? Because the C language was reliable, it was very, very simple, it is very simple, and it is easy to use as well as easy to learn. It's a very easy language. That is why even if you see in your school, in your colleges, in the first year of your college, first semester of your college, they teach C language. Now what are some of the benefits of C language? So I'll just give an overview. I'm not going to read this everything, all of these things here, because I want all of you to, at least after the class, you should at least go through this PPT once. So C language is a middle level language, so which is having a features of both high level as well as low level languages. You have three level languages, like you have a high level language, you have a middle level language, and you have a low level language. Now you have Java and .NET. These are basically your high level languages. And earlier when they designed the C language, C was also considered as a high level language. But as the new languages evolved, a lot of things evolved. That is why now C considered as a middle level language. And now you have a low level languages also. So for example, you have assembly language, so they are low level languages. So C is considered as a middle level language nowadays. and it is very, very popular because the executing the C code is very fast. C language directly communicates with the hardware, so it's executing the C code is very, very fast. That is why C language is still using the C language to write drivers and kernels for operating system, and that's why it became so popular, right? Which you have different kind of programming language. You have a structured programming language, you have procedure programming language, you have object oriented programming language, you have functional programming language. Just go through after the lecture, just go through the difference between all of them. What is a functional programming language? What is a object oriented programming language? What is a procedural programming language? What is a structural programming language? Just go through the difference between all of them. So we call that C language is a structured programming language. It is structured, right? So there's a huge difference between C++ and C. So, okay. Now, so it also follows the free movement of data. We'll see that. And there's some features which in C which is that gives a direct access to machine level hardware APIs. So that is why it is used to even write lot of kernels and drivers, because it gives lot of freedom to the people like us. Okay, and the C language is case sensitive, which means the lower and upper letters are treated differently. For example, if you write ABC and ABC, so these are two different words because this is a capital A and this is a small a. So C is a case sensitive language. There are many languages which are case sensitive. There are some languages which are not case sensitive. Okay. Now, again, more benefits of C language, as you can see here. So this C language is highly portable because it is very light. So it is highly portable. It is very, very light, and it is used for scripting the system applications. Your system applications ko script karne ke liye use hoti hai. For example, you have Windows, Unix and Linux operating system. System applications are generally scripted by C language. Okay, and it is a general purpose language. So general purpose language means it is not designed for a specific work. People can use it for different kinds of work. You can design applications using C language, you can design games using C language, you can design graphics using C language, right? So you can design applications which require intensive calculations, so you can design different kind of applications using C language. C is a general purpose programming language. It is not specialized. Okay, now for example, if you say MATLAB, now this MATLAB is a specialized language. Okay, so it is basically designed for scientific use, but C language is a general purpose language. It is designed so that you can do any work with the C language. Now in the last I guess it is 40-50 years, so it was designed in 1970s and now it is 2020. So roughly it has been 50 years. From past 50 years, people have done a lot of work in C language. There are a lot of huge number of libraries that are available. They have developed a lot of things in the C language. Even you can see that the programming languages like C++ as well as Objective-C, they are just a derivatives of C language. See, what happened is, let me give you a brief idea. In 1970s, the C language was developed. Then from C language, they developed a language which is C++. Now from C++ and C, there's one more language which is Objective-C. So Objective-C took the benefit of C as well as C++. Your Mac operating systems and this your iOS, these are generally written with Objective-C, because C can directly communicate with the hardware. So this makes it very, very powerful. The Objective-C language is very, very powerful. And even you can see the Macintosh operating system, it is very powerful, it is very fast, it is very efficient, as well as your iOS is also very fast and very efficient. But if you see from the C++, there are other languages like Java. So Java adopted the object-oriented features of C++. Jo C++ ke andar kuch mistakes thi, kuch kamiyan thi, so Java replaced those things. And again, the .NET programming language adopted the features of Java. So if you can see, this languages like C++, Java and .NET, these languages are also taking a lot of things from C language, because C++ was an implementation of C language. Then Java adopted the feature of C++, and then .NET adopted the features of Java. So they are dependent on each other, like. So that is why C became so popular, and the other languages which they have developed over the C language. Okay. So as you can see, from C language created the basis for C++. We also have C minus, you also have C sharp. So C sharp is basically .NET. You have Objective-C. So this is Objective-C is used to develop Mac operating systems or iOS, or Apple is basically using Objective-C. Then you also have BitC, you have C shell, you have CSH, you have D, you have Java, you have JavaScript, you have Go, Rust. So most of these languages, they are using the lot of things which the C language basically, you know, introduced. So these, that is why the C language became very, very popular. Now, what does the structure of a C program looks like? C program ka structure kaisa dikhta hai? So in a C program, you first of all have a header file. For example, as you can see here, hash include is a header file. Then after this header file, you have a main function, and then you can declare your variable. You can have some body part which where you are giving some different kind of logics. For example, you can also have integer C is equal to A plus 1. So this is also a section which comes in the body part, and then you have a return statement. So basically your entire C program is divided into various sections. So first section is your header, the second section is your main function, the third section is maybe your variable declaration. So variable declaration, again, it is a sub part of body, and the fourth section is a return type, which is again a sub part of body. So you have header, main section, variable declaration, body of the program, and the return statement. Okay, so as you can see here, we have a header file. Good. So we have header files here. So we have various header files, and these header files end with the extension .h. Okay. Now these are some of the header files which we use on day-to-day basis. For example, you have stdinf.h, we have stdint.h, you have stdio.h. So std means standard input standard. So std means standard. Okay, so you can have a header file which is stdio, that is standard input output. If I say we have stdlib, so stdlib means standard library. We have a header file which is string.h. We have a header file which is math.h. So in the same way, there are a lot of different header files that are existing, as well as you can also create your own header file. So basically, header files is just a set of a program which helps us to include the features which are included in those header files. I believe you already know what are a header file, so that is why I am not giving you a complete explanation regarding a header file, because I believe that all of you are BTech and master level students, and you have studied C language or any other programming language also. That is why there is no requirement of giving a complete detail what is a header file. Now here you can just see some of the definitions here, but we will be using these header files later on also. So for example, if I say we have stdinf.h, so it means standard definitions or standard defines. So this can be used to define various macros. When I say stdint.h, so int means integer, that is standard integer. So basically you can define the length of an integer. Then you have stdio.h, that is standard input output, which gives us a functionality of taking the input from the user and giving the output to the user. For example, you have printf, print something onto the screen, or you have a scanf, or take some input from the user. Or maybe you have a header file like stdlib.h, which is standard library, so which gives a various different features. For example, you can use a functions like malloc, so which is for memory allocation. So you can have like numeric conversions which can be used using this, right? So there are a lot of things which is defined inside the stdlib.h. So we'll be looking at these later on also. And then you have string.h. So if you want to handle some string, for example, in the printf function, if you want to have %s of, or you need some functions which are related to the string only, like you have string length, str, len. So those functions are defined here in the string.h header file. And then you have maths.h. Maths.h is if you want to have some math functions. that you can include in your that you want to include in your program. So that means I'm going to use math.h. Now, what is the syntax to include a header file? It is very, very easy. It is going to be something like this: hash include. Let us suppose I want to include stdio.h, so it is stdio.h. And generally, you write the header file in the beginning of the program, or you can say first few lines of the program, you give the header files. Okay, so this is the general syntax that you have to write hash include and the name of the header file, and in the end, the extension is .h. Okay, so this is an example of a syntax. How do you declare the main method? So in the main method, why it is interesting, we have to see this main method itself. See, whenever you are going to execute a program, your program execution starts with the main function. Okay, so generally it is something like this: you have hash include. Now here you can see in this main function, so generally every all your programs are having a main function because your program execution starts from the main function only. So your compiler does not see this header files in the beginning, so they are included while compiling this program, but again your program execution will start from the main function. You can have any number of functions before this, you can have a fun function, you can have any number of functions, but your program execution will start from the main function only. And secondly, there are some compilers which will force you to take some input parameters also. For example, you might be having integer main, and you may be having some input parameter like void something, some input parameter, right? So there are some compilers which will force you to take input parameters. There are some compilers which will also force you to give this return type. Okay, so it depends on compiler to compiler. We will see that concept today also, why they are asking such kind of things. Secondly, your variable declaration. I think you already know what is this variable declaration. So you can declare different variables in the program, and this is the body of a program where you can give different kind of logics that you want to give. For example, here I'm just taking an integer a and I'm just trying to print the value of a. So this body is basically where you write your logic of the program. Okay, and then you have a return statement. So for example, here we are returning a value 0. So this, if you want have a, this is a return type. So because here it is a return type as int, so we are returning a value 0, and this value will be returned to your compiler by saying that my program execution is now finished. So because the program execution is now finished, so what will happen in this case, your compiler will know that program execution is finished. So it is a elegant termination of the program. So sometimes what happens is, dekho, what happens is when you compile the programs like GCC, in the compilers like GCC, or even if you are trying to use an online compiler, for example it is IDE1, this is an online C compiler. Now if you try to compile this program in this online compiler, what will happen in that case is, if you are returning this value 0, this compiler will know that yes, your program is finished, and now it will take the steps. But if you are not including this value, if you are not including the return type, what will happen in that case is that your program will execute successfully. There's no problem in execution of the program successfully, but your program will terminate abruptly. It will terminate abruptly. So basically this abrupt termination, whether the compiler will give some kind of warning regarding this, or whether the compiler will give some kind of error regarding this, that depends on compiler to compiler. So for example, this is the basic program. As you can see, what we are doing here in this program, we have a header file hash include stdio.h. We have a main function. So here the return type of main function is integer, and here the main function is taking an input parameter as void. Sometimes some compilers will not ask for any input parameters. Some compilers will ask for one input parameter. Some compilers might also ask for two input parameters, not just one. They might also ask for two input parameters. So we'll be looking at this in this lecture only. And here we have printf statement, so which is printing digimon to education, and it is returning type as 0. So we are returning this value 0 to the compiler and we are telling that yes, the program has terminated successfully. Now you can finish your work or you can do something else, something like this, right? Okay, so I think so there's no requirement of this. There is no requirement of this PPT also. These PPTs I have added for your understanding. If you want to use this PPT as a notes, so you can study from these what is happening here. So you can study them as a notes. Okay, so as you can see here, when I'm returning as zero, that means it is successful termination of the program. So the PPTs that I'm skipping, I'm feeling that these things you already know, so that specifically I'm skipping them. Okay.